play hockey, you play hockey to win. You know, winning the most game is what it's all about. When you play hockey to win. And for a goalie, it's a beautiful thing because when you win, everybody's happy around you. Really, for me, what it's hockey's all about.
Martin Brodeur began the 08-09 season just 13 wins shy of Patrick Waugh's all-time record of 551. Brodeur entered training camp with a renewed focus. For the first time that summer, the 36-year-old worked with a personal trainer. His 16th NHL season was shaping up to be a big one.
Saved by Brodeur. Rebound Brodeur with a second stop. Got the glove out.
The season began like many others for the Devils.
Yes! Devils win!
Brodeur was his old self, posting two shutouts in his first six games, pacing New Jersey to a 5-2-2 record in October.
Marty Brodeur, career win number 541.
He's every bit the front runner in the early season to win another Vezina.
But on November 1st, disaster struck.
Gave it in front for Whiteshot. Scramble there in Brodeur's ball. And he is slow to get up.
Marty in some pain, and he's being looked at.
Everybody in the building, well, kind of a hush settles over this place, and they're wondering how the franchise goaltender is.
Initially thought to be a bruised elbow, the diagnosis was much worse.
We got word that it looks like Marty Brodeur is going to be out 3 or 4 months.
Marty Brodeur will be out 3 to 4 months.
Bicep surgery, big loss for this team.
Sitting just 7 wins away from tying Waugh, the record would have to wait. Life without Marty came easier than expected for the Devils. Kevin Weeks and the emergence of Scott Clemenson would stem the tide for New Jersey. But as much as the Devils were getting by without Marty, life away from hockey wasn't easy for Brodeur.
When you're a competitive, player, you'd like to be in there and do your share. You know, I mean, you've missed it for so long that you get so close, and I mean, that's the toughest part is to wait it out.
On February 26th, the Devils stood in first place in the Atlantic Division. Almost 4 months after his injury, Martin Brodeur made his much-anticipated return against Colorado.
The front forehand shot by Hayduk is blocked off by Brodeur. Brodeur has it. 55 games since his last shutout. Big return for Brodeur.
A shutout in his return would mark the 99th of his career. 4 days later, Brodeur hit the century mark.
Powell shoots one safe. Rebound. Oh, and another save, Brodeur. Some of the fans are starting to stand here because for Marty Brodeur, it is shutout number 100. Woohoo!
Two shutouts in his first 3 games back dispelled any notion that Brodeur would need time to find his game. As the starts continued, so did the wins. With his 550th win, Brodeur had booked a date with destiny.
When I started with winning the 4 straight games, now, you know, that date kind of popped up a little bit. So maybe the Montreal could be the one. You know, hopefully I won't disappoint anybody. I know everybody's here to see it, and hopefully we'll give it to them.
Saturday night in his hometown of Montreal, in front of friends, family, and Patrick Waugh himself, Brodeur stared down the record of his boyhood idol.
Timer Castiglia and Brodeur with the lightning quick glove. Brodeur's got that as well. Tonight, there is company for Patrick Waugh atop the all-time wins list. For Marty Brodeur, 551.
The entire arena here in Montreal standing, cheering their native son. Tuesday night, St. Patrick's Day. Will it become St. Marty's Day?
It's pretty rare that you go to a visiting team and you get that ovation from their fans. You know, I know it's a little different because of the Montreal connection, but I think just for them to recognize what I've done here was pretty cool. You know, it was something that I'll remember all my life.
Tying the record in Montreal, Brodeur would get the chance to break the record 3 days later in front of his home fans.
He took advice from no one. His coach said, "Would you like to be a goalie?" And he said, "Okay, I'll do it." And here he is on the precipice of one of several records that lie ahead. The trailer is at Parise, the owner of 40 goals this year. Centered one in front. Score! Langenfeld! with this is Hamblin again. Sets it back for Seabrook, and the shot kicked out by Brodeur. Rebound is poked along. Kleosh able to get it on back now to Paul Martin. Martin dealt it back in. Parise threw one in front. Score! Zajac! 2-0. Buffalo area native. Corral that got it over across for a shot that was turned aside by Brodeur. And the first period is in the books with the Devils leading 2-0.
Boy, you couldn't have written the script any better. The Devils got the first two goals, set the tempo and the pace. Marty with a bunch of good saves.
Here is Taves across in an attempt at the front of the net, squipped in on Brodeur. He had to battle Johnny Oduya just to get the shot away. Campbell drops, Brower the shot. Save Brodeur and another save on King. And the rebound he grabs and hangs on. Sent in front by Campbell and a block by Motto. Another drive, they score! Minutes have been played in this game. Keith with a blast, turned aside by Brodeur and sent aside to the boards. Brodeur handles. Up the boards, off Eliash. Bufflin a shot, he scores! Dustin Bufflin from the slot, and it's 3-2. 92 years, 613 goaltenders have played at least a period in the NHL. Some of them two decades. Some of them did not wear masks, had only a baseball fielder's glove to catch with. 8.9 to go, Taves against Madden. Taves flopped it on back. Barker kept it, shot one, blocked down in front. Oh, and a pad stop made by Brodeur. Cleared back along, not out. One more by Barker, blocked. And Marty Brodeur is the winningest goaltender in the NHL.
As a teenager, you grew up rooting for Patrick Waugh. What does it mean to break his cherished record?
Well, it doesn't really matter who old it. You know, I think Patrick was a pioneer in goaltending, and so for me, just to be around these guys, I'm just, blessed. I've been playing for a great organization, great fans, great teammates, all my career coaches, and also this is a lot of fun. It's been tough in the last week. There's a lot of things to do, so now we could go on and finish the season strong and get ourselves into playoffs and do some damage.
You have one very special visitor here tonight. It was a working night for your father as well. What has your father, Denis, meant to your career?
Well, it means everything. You know, I think for me, having my family, especially my dad in the building tonight, is something that, I'm pretty proud that I was able to live all these experiences with him and through him at the same time. So thanks, Dad.
I look around, my mom's not there, my dad's not there, like by myself, 6 years old, 7 years old actually, and I'm like, well, I'll be a goalie. And so that kind of turned out to be probably the biggest decision I ever made, you know?
Before there was Martin, there was Denis. Denis Brodeur was a goaltender himself and considered a very good one at that. In 1956, he played for the Kitchener-Waterloo Dutchmen, the team that represented Canada at the Winter Olympics in Cortina d'Ampezzo, Italy. The Canadians won the bronze. Following the end of his own hockey career, Denis Brodeur became a sports photographer for Le Matin, a Montreal newspaper. As good as he was a goaltender, he was even better as a photographer.
That's flattering because I played in the Olympics, but I played one about 5 days in the American League. I think my biggest accomplishment was as a photographer. The three boys there, they used to come in and see pictures all the time of the game. And they used to see maybe Lafleur would come in and choose some pictures for himself and stuff like that. I used to bring them to help me out when I do headshots to, set up my lighting and stuff like that. So they live into hockey.
I saw Guy Lafleur when I was young. Always say being a lot of respect for my dad, and a lot of people was talking to my dad. And Marty, I think he learned a lot from that, just to be how to be professional with the media, with the people around the game. You know, I think it's very important.
Every time I go to a hockey game, I used to come in with maybe a different story of how one guy react when I ask him to take some pictures and stuff like that. Actually, all through my career, never had any problem with any hockey player. I couldn't say the same thing with 30 years of baseball. I used to tell that to the boys, so probably they react to that and they didn't do that.
Coming from a family with a former goaltender as a father and two older brothers heavily involved in sports, it didn't take long for Martin to get involved.
My earliest memory is Martin with his skate for the first time with a chair, pulling a chair and skating with a chair and having trouble falling down, getting up. He didn't mind, but there were so many kids on the ice at the time, you know. Maybe at first of the year, they have maybe 50 kids with each a chair, pulling a chair, and that was his first skating.
An ironic chapter in Martin's storied career is that he didn't even start as a goalie.
When he played hockey, he was a good scorer. He could skate very well, would score 2-3 goals a game. And we like that. Parents like scoring goals.
The following year, coming into the rink, I got my hockey equipment on and don't even have my goalie equipment, nothing. I'm just getting as a forward because I was only a backup. And the coach goes, well, what do you want to do this year? So I'm like, what do you mean? Well, do you want to be a goalie or you want to be a forward? And I look around, my mom's not there, my dad's not there, and like by myself, 6 years old, 7 years old actually. And I'm like, well, I'll be a goalie. And so that kind of turned out to be probably the biggest decision I ever made, you know?
Yeah, I was happy because I could see him through me, you know? His older brother was coaching him in Pee Wee, and I only went on the ice once with Martin. I didn't want to interfere, but that time I showed him how to stop the puck behind the net, cut passes, and clear his net, around his net. So that's the only thing that I showed him, and just one time. I guess he picked it up fast. One year, when he was midget AAA, so the question was, should he play college or should he play in the junior league? So I went to the forum that night and I met Prof Caro and I met Serge Savard and Perron, the coach of Montreal Canadiens, and they all told me, if you think he has a chance, he's good enough, maybe if he played the junior league, he gets more shots than in college. I think at that time we did the right decision.
Patrick Waugh with a brilliant save with just 14 seconds remaining, preserving the 4-3 win.
1986, the Montreal Canadiens, led by a 20-year-old Patrick Waugh, won their 23rd Stanley Cup. Waugh became the youngest player ever to win the Conn Smythe Trophy, leaving an image that was forever etched in the memory of a young Brodeur.
It was unbelievable. You know, I think for me, to see the Canadiens win the Stanley Cup, going to the parade, you know, kind of left school for one day, left school with my buddies, took our bikes, went downtown Montreal on Peel Street in St. Catherine and just sat on the corner and see the Stanley Cup parade in front of us. That's where I think everything started for me, just to see, you know, Patrick Waugh at a young age be able to see what he did during the playoffs that year, and it's like, just makes you believe that you're able to do it when it hits you so close from home.
The next three games, Martin's on the bench and the coach is hardly talking to him. So Martin says, that's okay, I'm just gonna have fun, go skiing, whatever.
You know, after a week, my brother just kind of grabbed me by the shoulder and dragged me right back to the rink. He goes, you're gonna be playing hockey, that's what you're gonna do.
As Martin entered his teen years, he continued to develop as a solid goaltender. However, at age 14, an incident occurred that almost made Brodeur quit hockey altogether. It was a decision that his family knew he would have regretted for the rest of his life.
The way I remember it, you know, it's a day where my mother died. So we phoned the coach and said Martin will be at the game because he's going to attend at the funeral to see his grandmother. And Martin was playing all the games there. And when we came back, the next three games, Martin's on the bench and the coach is hardly talking to him. So Martin says, that's okay, I'm just gonna have fun, go skiing, whatever.
Like any teenager, I think you're going through up and down and what do you do? And sometimes, I had enough. You know, I wanted to do something. I see all my buddies doing other things and I was like, oh, you know, that would be fun not to have a coach, not to have a time to be somewhere, you know, for the first time in my life.
He wanted to quit hockey to go with me alpine skiing. And my big brother Claude said, no, you gotta stay. You're good. You're gonna stay.
You know, after a week, my brother just kind of grabbed me by the shoulder and dragged me right back to the rink. He goes, "You're gonna be playing hockey. That's what you're gonna do." And so I thank him every day for that. That's for sure. The older I was getting, more I was seeing that I was living their dream. You know, and that really pushed me and wanted to do more for them because they were there for day one and driving me to the rink. And you know, like I said, my brother dragged me back to the rink to play hockey. And for me, it was just a fun experience to have my whole family at all times right beside me along the way.
The Brodeur family has always been there to support Martin. And through his father's connections, he was able to receive guidance from some well-known sports figures.
Tretiak, for me, really helped Martin. I was taking pictures at that August school, and when Tretiak came in, well, I asked the guy, can Martin come in, you know? So he came in as a student 3 years. And then the following 2 years, he helped out as a helper to Tretiak.
Tretiak was always an icon, you know, one of the best goalies in the world that never played in the NHL. And so when he had his camp, it was a great honor for me to be part of it. First as student for a couple of years, and after that as a teacher with him.
Tretiak was regarded by many as the greatest butterfly goaltender of all time. The significance of getting a chance to work with the great Russian was not lost on the young Brodeur, but still, Martin was hesitant to implement the butterfly style. As the first ever goaltending coach of the Montreal Canadiens, Francois Allaire encouraged his students that getting down into the butterfly and taking up as much net as possible were keys to success. It was difficult to argue Allaire's methods when his prized pupil Patrick Roy had stormed onto the scene in the NHL. But after attending one of Allaire's classes, Martin knew the butterfly wasn't for him.
And the practice at 4 o'clock was over. I went to get him and said, "Dad," he said, "I'm not gonna go back no more." I said, "Why?" "Well," I said, "he really wants me to play butterfly. I don't want to play butterfly."
Allaire teaches a different way than I do, but they always do the same thing. It's butterfly, 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 hoping the puck hits him with no control. Marty was the type of guy that he wants to control his game. Like, not just going out of the net, like you see him, he's probably the best going out of the net, but he didn't want to be stuck to the ice too long.
Martin created a unique goaltending approach for himself that's been described as a hybrid style, incorporating the techniques used by butterfly and stand-up goaltenders.
Marty Brodeur plays with a style that is not only amazing to the fans and forwards, but goalies have said to me many times, "How does he stop the puck like that?"
Marty is, I think, he's first of all, he's a big man. I mean, he covers a lot of space in the net, but he's got great reflex. I mean, he's got great hands, very quick.
If you're a butterfly guy, when a puck goes through a certain area, you're thinking, "I'm going down and I'm going to make this guy beat me over my shoulder," where Marty will move across one time, give you a glove, and see if you'll take it.
Anticipation is being right on top of the play all the time, the best angle possible. And if you can control the rebounds, better in this way also, because it's not as, you don't have to stretch so much, and you could control the game a lot better.
You could take Marty Brodeur's mask off, as they did through the 30s and 40s and 50s and 60s, and Marty Brodeur would maybe take him 2 days to adjust.
Marty Brodeur's equipment is the equipment of yesteryear. Maybe some fabrics have changed, maybe there's some a little improvement in the leathers and stuff like that, but you check out the way, the size of his equipment, the way he wears the pads strapped around the knees as tight as they were always worn, he wouldn't look out of place. His pads are the same, other than a few modifications over the years, as when he started.
One aspect of Brodeur's game that he always has taken pride in is his puck handling.
My dad came back one night after working a game against the Flyers in Montreal, and he said, "Watch the news, watch this guy, he's like a third defenseman out there." And that stayed in me, and I always was looking to see of him all the time in the news or even some of the games, just to see what he was doing. And you know, like everybody knows, that's one of the things I put in my own game also, but it's really because of Ron Extall.
I think you always feel good when you've had an effect on kids' lives, and obviously a kid that grows up watching you and then you play against him, it's a pretty neat thing. I remember when I came in the league, certain guys, you grow up idolizing them, and then all of a sudden you're playing against them, and it's a pretty neat thing.
I love the fact, you know, that he was playing the puck. He was probably one of the first goalies that came out and played the puck.
And Potvin and Hextall are going to go. I know Felix doesn't think this is a good idea.
He was a little rough, maybe, to my liking, but I thought that was entertaining. But I think playing the puck was the biggest thing.
We look at
the New Jersey Devils, who are picking right now.
Trying to think who would want a goaltender.
We don't want to make ourselves out to be geniuses, because if we thought that Marty Brodeur was going to be the player he is today, we would have been trading up, not trading down.
June 16th, 1990. The NHL Entry Draft is hosted by the Vancouver Canucks at BC Place. It will be remembered in years to come as one of the deepest drafts in NHL history, with 14 of the first 21 picks going on to play at least 500 games in the NHL. The New Jersey Devils held the 11th pick, but general manager Lou Lamoriello and director of player personnel Marshall Johnston were willing to move down in the draft. Calgary wanted that number 11 pick.
Look at the New Jersey Devils, who are picking right now and still in the midst of their timeouts. Any insight into what they might be doing, guys?
I'm trying to think who would want a goaltender.
Well, in that draft, Calgary really did think that Trevor Kidd was by far the best goaltending prospect available. And that was the common sentiment at the time. This wasn't just the Flames thinking that. That was everybody.
We liked Monty better than we liked Trevor Kidd. And we knew that Calgary was very interested in Kidd. So we felt that Marty would be there. Never know. So we made the trade where we traded 13th at that given time for 20, and we received the second round pick. And we were fortunate enough to get Marty, and we all know how he's turned out. We don't want to make ourselves out to be geniuses, because if we thought that Marty Brodeur was going to be the player he is today, we would have been trading up, not trading down. We had the late Warren Strelo at that given time as a goalie coach, and he was out looking. He liked Marty. Marshall, we had Max, we had David Conte, myself. We were all in to see Marty. You know, once we sat down and spoke to him, we knew his character. We also knew that he didn't put any timetable on when he made it to the NHL. In my mind, he was going out in the second round. So when Turner Stevenson got picked up, I was working for Montreal then. So I followed them through the Canadian table, take all the pictures, and the PR from Montreal Canadiens asked me to take Savard, Jean Beliveau was there, and a group of five with Stevenson. Then I heard New Jersey's picked up Martin. So I said, I'm sorry, you guys, I'll do the picture later on. And I ran in front and got all those pictures. So. That was something.
New Jersey already had veteran netminders in Sean Burke and Chris Terreri. So Brodeur returned to junior for the 1990-91 season.
I think the unique thing about Marty Brodeur, especially in today's hockey world, is that he was given nothing. He wasn't this hotshot junior goalie that people are saying, this kid can't miss. He's going to be great. He didn't hear those kind of accolades.
That summer, the Devils made another monumental draft selection.
I am proud to welcome to New Jersey, from the Kamloops Blazers of the Western Hockey League, Scott Niedermeyer.
Scott Niedermeyer from Kamloops.
That wasn't the only significant transaction the Devils made that offseason. Through a landmark NHL arbitration case, the Devils added a Hall of Famer to their blue line. In a matter of just 15 months, the Devils had brought Brodeur, Niedermeyer, and Stevens to their franchise. Chris Terreri and Craig Billington were handed the netminders' duties for the upcoming season. Brodeur would play once again in the QMJHL. However, towards the end of that season, both Terreri and Billington suffered injuries. The door had opened for Brodeur.
Well, it was surreal a little bit. You know, I think when you play junior, you don't expect to make a big jump to the NHL, especially not in a week, you know. You always dream about it.
I remember he called me and he said, Denny, I'm going emergency recall to play for the Devils. And I said, no, there's no way. He was like, he's still second year junior or something.
March 26th, 1992. The New Jersey Devils were at home to the Boston Bruins. With only six games remaining in the season, the Devils were just trying to stop the bleeding. With just one win in their previous nine games, Brodeur was pushed into the spotlight.
I always remember where I was standing, and Tom McVie kind of put me on the spot in the morning and says, you're a blank kid, you know, with his big rogue voice.
I went there, got lost in the highways down there, made it for the warm-up, didn't stop a puck. During the warm-up, everything was flying over his head in between his pads. I was like, it's gonna be a long night. Next thing you know, he won his game. His first game, I was there, and I'm proud to be at that game that night.
The game would go down as a 4-2 win for New Jersey. Years later, that win took on a much greater meaning.
Right from the get-go, I think everybody was really happy about me playing my first game. I mean, you have to realize that back then, 19 years old, you didn't see many goalies playing that early.
You know, you're always concerned when a kid, especially a goaltender, is thrown into that situation. So I don't think he had time to really worry about the situation he was in. I mean, maybe he looks back on it, maybe he was a little nervous, I don't know, but he certainly didn't show it.
Even at a young age when he was a baby and had that baby face, he just seemed like he was one of those kids who was going to come in there, and that's what you need out of your goaltender, the most important position in the game. And Marty came in there and you could tell this kid's got something special, a little bit different about him, that nothing seems to rattle him, and you can notice that early on, even in his first game.
The following season, Brodeur spent the year with New Jersey's top minor league club, the Utica Devils of the American Hockey League. However, he would start the 93-94 season as the backup to Chris Terreri. And it wouldn't take long for new head coach Jacques Lemaire to anoint Brodeur as the number one.
Is it over? No! What an athletic move by Martin Brodeur.
I was looking at him in practices and I said, well, this kid, you know, he's got potential. He's athletic and he's quick and he's got great hands, great feet, you know. So why wouldn't I give him a shot?
The thing that you remember too, though, is it's almost the perfect storm for him coming in here, because him being, you know, coached well right from the get-go. I mean, you know, Jacques, he had a, you know, a French-Canadian goalie coach. We had a French-Canadian coach, and it just seemed to work. Everything seemed to work in his favor.
Jacques Caron and Jacques Lemaire spoke French. Marty at a young age, certainly the English language can at different times be interpreted different ways from somebody who hasn't been speaking every day. So the message was always clear and direct.
On the backs of Stevens, Niedermeyer, and Brodeur, New Jersey celebrated the first 100-point season in franchise history. Brodeur finished second in goals against and fourth in save percentage. Accordingly, Brodeur won the Calder Trophy as top rookie. It was just the first of many NHL awards to come. Had ended in devastating fashion, done in by Mark Messier's infamous guarantee.
Score! Rebound! Score! Do you believe it? He said we will win game six. He has just picked up the hat trick.
And then by Stéphane Matteau's heartbreaking goal in double overtime in game seven.
You go all the way to the conference final, you go to game seven, you go into overtime, you know, it's like you can't go further than that. And losing by a goal like that too is kind of a cheesy goal. I took that pretty tough because I felt that we had a great chance to win.
I mean, he really did play well in that that series we had against them, as good as any goalie we've played against.
That was a learning experience for all of us, including Marty, and he played exceptionally well.
That night he was not very happy, of course, but he came out of it very fast and he figured, well, you know, it's a great experience and we'll go next year.
He was determined not to let another opportunity slip away. After a slow start to the 95 season, Brodeur and his teammates found themselves fighting for a playoff spot. A hot second half helped them secure the fifth seed in the East and a first round playoff date with the storied Boston Bruins. Brodeur quickly showed that his playoff form of 1994 was no fluke.
Marty improved from, you know, the 94 situation, which didn't work out, but we all learned from that.
Oh, the Bruins came that close.
Screenshot, save, loose puck, jab that, oh, can't put it in.
Back-to-back shutouts in Boston gave the Devils a stranglehold.
You feel invincible, you know, you're out there and you say, well, if they get it, it's going to be a lucky goal or something, you know. So, you know, it won't happen again probably in my career, and I enjoyed it.
And he did not let up from there.
This pass in front, quick shot! Oh, there it is! Tchaikovsky robbed by Brodeur! Absolute highway robbery! And a save by Brodeur!
Another shot snapped out of the air by Brodeur!
The Bruins coming on, and Brodeur heating up. We probably haven't given
given much credit to Locker. If you allow two goals a game against, then you should win any hockey game.
And plus, the guy you're playing against is Martin Brodeur.
The New Jersey Devils win it 3-2. The Devils beat the Bruins out 4-1. 3 of the 4 victories were shutout wins. Brodeur has been an absolute star in this series.
In closing out the Bruins, history would note that Brodeur would be credited with the victory in the last meaningful hockey game at Boston Garden. But it was the future Brodeur had his eye on, and that meant a series against the Penguins.
Another draw won by Francis. Great stop by Brodeur! And Brodeur made an unbelievable stop.
And in front of Francis, save made by Brodeur. Another stop made by Martin Brodeur.
Brodeur is the man that's making the difference here.
Shoot, save made by Brodeur, and he covers.
Jager shot, blocked, save Brodeur. Jager with some help, a shot, big save.
And a celebration goes on for Martin Brodeur and the New Jersey Devils. And the Devils are headed to Philadelphia.
We're not favorite, you know, we're not favorite right at the start, and we came out and proved that, you know, we can play against any team. You know, it could be a defensive team like we played Boston, and now it's a really offensive team, and we shut them out to 8 goals all this for 5 games. I think that's a great honor for us.
Back-to-back Game 5 series victories had put the Devils into the conference final for the second straight year. But the experience gained in 1994 kept the Devils and Brodeur focused and even more hungry.
His numbers are looking like Terry Sawchuk's numbers in the playoffs.
Next up for Brodeur was a matchup against one of his idols, Ron Hextall, and the vaunted Philadelphia Flyers.
Lean coming, McTavish open in the middle. Backhand shot, Brodeur! In front, Rendemore shot, save again!
If he sees it, he stops it.
It's over. The Devils win it 5-2, lead the series 2-0.
For the second year in a row, the Devils took a 3-2 lead in the Eastern Conference Final. With last year's heartbreaking loss against the Rangers etched in his mind, Brodeur was determined not to let another opportunity slip away. Brodeur and his mates were big underdogs against the heavily favored Red Wings.
No one gave us a chance that year, definitely, because the Red Wings were the powerhouse of the league at that point.
I knew he would hold us in there. The only question mark was, can we score a goal against them? You know, because they were the best club. I mean, we were the underdog, could be 10-1.
Detroit hadn't won the Stanley Cup in 40 years, and after leading the league in points during the regular season, most believed this was their best chance to end the drought. The Devils and Brodeur were not to be intimidated.
When you think we're going up against Detroit, you know, best record in the NHL, everybody and anybody was saying they were going to beat us 4 straight. We turned the tables on them. Those first 2 games in Detroit, Marty saw a lot of rubber and stood tall.
We certainly knew that his time had come. He was going to be our backbone and, you know, and our leader for the future.
Martin Brodeur continues his magnificent performance in net.
The Devils stunned the hockey world by sweeping both games in Detroit. Brodeur extended his record by winning his 10th road game of the playoffs and tied another by winning his 7th straight road game. And when the series resumed in New Jersey, the story remained the same.
He gets out front of the net, the backhander, loose puck there!
June 24, 1995, Martin Brodeur sat 1 win away from the Cup. And just as he had in the 19 previous playoff games during the run, he stymied the opposition.
The Devils win the Stanley Cup!
Great series. There's Brodeur. Oh, I guess so.
Where's Martin? How's it feel? Oh, it's great. You know, there's nothing to... It's hard to explain. You know, it's an unbelievable feeling.
Stanley Cup won by the New Jersey Devils.
That right there kind of put Marty on a, you know, a little bit of limelight, because he's still a very young goalie, won his first Stanley Cup, and I'm sure a lot of people were wondering, you know, will the kid be able to sustain that and continue his career and play as well as he played there? And, you know, here we are, how many years later, looking and saying, you know, guess what? He did it, and he's here.
Goal from the Stanley Cup champion New Jersey Devils, number 30, Martin Brodeur.
In just his third NHL season, Martin Brodeur had already won the Calder Trophy, a Stanley Cup, and in 1996, he was voted to the Eastern Conference All-Star Team. We take you back to the Fleet Center in Boston and relive some of the sights and sounds from Brodeur's first All-Star experience. First, the skills competition.
Can you hear me? All right. The way they do it, it's a little scary, eh? The breakaways, all six guys gonna look at us and just, okay, it's my turn to go.
Brodeur has such tremendous reach. Joe Sakic scored.
I knew it too. But I said, I bet.
It's a tough shot for a lefty though, man.
Yeah. But you know what? These shots here all the time, I was going for there. We need three goals to tie.
We don't want to tie. Matthew Schneider of the Islanders. And we're tied.
Mario, you better score. You better score.
And Potvin made two stops up. So we are tied. How do you like that?
You're the man, Dominic. Come on, Dominic.
23 goals on the year. And he scores here high.
I would have a glove on that. You got to pick me.
After having some fun in the skills competition, Brodeur made his first career start in an All-Star game.
In goal from the Stanley Cup champion New Jersey Devils, number 30, Martin Brodeur.
Guys, don't look at me like that when I'm talking, okay? I don't like it.
Sundin is in. Sundin with a backhander. But it is brought back. We have a penalty.
We have too many men on the ice for the Western side.
Not too many men. Wow. Wow.
Jagr, Messier, save, Belfour.
Wow, big save.
Brett Hall's shot denied by Brodeur.
I feel like you didn't want to kill me on that shot. You could have buried that more.
See that? It's all over.
What's going on with the Panthers right now? They're doing so well. Don't they? You're the key, man. That's why, eh?
Yeah. I'm the key. You know what? I was looking at Dominic before. He kind of looks like olive oil from Popeye.
It's the Dominator.
Dominator.
The Dominator is on our side.
Get down tonight.
Okay, let's get a big goal now, guys.
Messier, a shot, went off the leg, rebound, score! Woo!
It was great. Something special I'll remember all the time. We won two, so that's even great.
Who are you putting your money on? I think that comes down to it. That's who I would put my money on. If I had a game to win, that's who I'd put in.
After winning the Stanley Cup in 1995, Martin Brodeur won a record 196 games over the next half decade, an NHL record for a five-year span. However, postseason success eluded him and his teammates. In 1996, as defending champions, they failed to make the playoffs. And 1997, 1998, and 1999 had all ended in postseason disappointment.
The Pittsburgh Penguins have planted the top seed in the East and are advancing to round two. A 105-point season spoiled again.
It appeared as though 2000 would end in similar fashion. The Devils looked to be headed for another collapse late in the season, when Lou Lamoriello surprised everyone by firing Robbie Fatorik and naming Larry Robinson as the team's new head coach. It was a risky move. The Devils ended up finishing fourth in the conference, setting up a first-round matchup with the Panthers and the league's top goal scorer, Pavel Bure. All eyes were on Brodeur.
To Bure, shoots, save made by Brodeur, and here comes Bure, moving on in with hits the drive and a save Brodeur.
Center in fast, just kept wide, way back.
series. Anakin goes back to the net, looking for someone. Out front, what a save! As Brodeur comes up with the puck off Ray Whitney.
They got the job done here. Swept the Panthers.
Next up, the Toronto Maple Leafs.
Martin Brodeur, 6 goals in 4 games against Florida. He is hot, they say. He is ready to go.
Would win game 4, sending the series back to Toronto tied at 2 for a big game 5. Now, Martin Brodeur faced a critical game 6 at home with a chance to reach the conference final for the first time in 5 years. Brodeur's workload would be limited to a record-setting 6 shots as the Devils clinch the series. Just as was the case during the Stanley Cup run of 1995, Brodeur and his mates were off to Philadelphia for a date with the Flyers in the conference final.
That's on the tape at center to tack it in.
Brodeur's mettle would be tested over the next 3 games. A loss in game 2 was compounded by some bad play in game 3.
Tockett loose right side. Here's Tockett pounding it. Rick Tockett's done it again.
The worst game I've played so far in the playoffs. That's how I felt.
It got no better in game 4 as the Flyers took a commanding 3-1 series lead. No team had ever overcome such a deficit in the conference final.
Celebration will start for the Devils. In the corner, centers, Tockett to the net, Brodeur down! Here's John LeClair moving in, and a good stop there by Brodeur. Right down to the wire, Primo in his skates, and now the game second. Hockey in front, Primo the shot, and Brodeur got the paddle down and made the save.
To Philly, and you know, we were able to battle back, win that series. You know, he made save after save, and you don't have any margin for error when you're down 3-1, but he never let a bad goal in after that. And he was the guy that stood up and said, come on, guys, we're not playing to our capabilities.
For the second time in his career, Martin Brodeur was playing in the Stanley Cup Final. This time, he would face the defending champion, Dallas Stars.
I think it's a little tougher probably when you get older. I think you're more conscious about what's going on right now, and it's a great feeling to be back.
We're set for the Stanley Cup Championship. Off the boards and center, Brodeur knocked it away. Patrick shot is stopped by the goalie. Gets over the line, the shot, rebound. Oh, what a big save by Brodeur. Great shot, a rebound. And Brodeur shot everything.
The Devils had won the opening game 7-3. But the Stars got the coveted split in New Jersey by winning game 2. As the scene shifted to Dallas, Brodeur upped his game.
Hatcher, put it in, look out. Here's a shot. That's
now with a chance to claim the cup on home ice, Brodeur had his best game yet.
Leeuwendijk sweeping it back on the goal. Unbelievable goaltending in the hockey game.
Brodeur had made 40 saves and found himself in a sudden death overtime, but his dream would be put on hold as Mike Modano ended the game in the third extra period. It had been a heartbreaking loss. Nevertheless, Brodeur and the Devils went on the road looking to clinch the cup.
Will there be a game seven, or will the Stanley Cup be presented here in Dallas tonight?
For the second game in a row, Brodeur had to work overtime. This time, he only had to wait until double overtime for the outcome to be decided.
Put it in wide of the net for Eliash to dig it out. Right in front, they score! The Stanley Cup goal is scored by Arnott. The New Jersey Devils are celebrating. The Devils of New Jersey have won the Stanley Cup.
Martin Brodeur, at age 27, had become a two-time Stanley Cup winner and silenced any critics who had said that his first cup was a fluke.
Well, he's just a winner, I guess. It's just, you know, who are you putting your money on? I think that comes down to it. That's who I would put my money on. If I had a game to win, that's who I'd put in.
I had a goaltender in Marty Brodeur who they believe was at the top of his game.
And like Nagano, where he didn't get the opportunity, he got the opportunity in Salt Lake City and he ran with it.
It's hard to explain, you know, it's an unbelievable feeling. When you hold that cup overhead, how did it feel when you saw your...
Man, this is unbelievable. This is the greatest feeling in my life. The greatest feeling. That's really good.
Just east of Montreal lies the working-class suburb of Saint-Léonard. Along with his four siblings, Martin Brodeur grew up in a modest bungalow on Rue Mauriac. Inside the Brodeur house, reminders of Martin are everywhere. Much like Walter Gretzky's basement, Denny Brodeur has transformed Martin's room into a photographic journey through his son's life.
Well, this is the room where Martin grew up. This is where Martin spent all his nights. I think he left around 16 to go to the junior team in Saint-Hyacinthe. So he stayed there for about 16 years. We took everything out when Martin started to go to New Jersey, and we knew he wouldn't come back here, so we decided to make sort of a photo room and a trophy room. When Martin was young, he didn't win as much trophies as many other kids, you know, but it seemed that when he got to be 13 or 14, he started going up fast and, you know, was playing real well, although he didn't want any very big trophies. You can see all these small trophies here. This is when Martin started to play hockey in the streets, and you can see that he's catching with the wrong hand because he had my old equipment. And after that, when he started as a goalie, see how young he was. And as we go down, it's different age. This one, he was drafted by the Canadian Junior, and he's with Jacques Lemaire, drafted him. And finally, that's when he had his first year as a junior with Saint-Hyacinthe. And that's where he was drafted in 1990 in Vancouver by the Devils in the first round.
The Devils have won the Stanley Cup!
This is the first Stanley Cup at the end of the 95 Stanley Cup with all the family. They closed the street. And we had a big party. We had about 2,000 people and came for each get a picture and autograph for Martin. Then we had the 2000 Stanley Cup. And this third one is the 203. As you know, players do and do all kinds of things with the cup. I know Martin had some popcorn and went to the theater with his two kids one night, and then this time he had some marshmallow in the cup. And then he was in the lake with the cup. And he held the cup over the water and put his head under the water for about a minute or so. So guys are so happy to win the cup, they do everything with it. And this is a great shot. I was giving him this by somebody in Toronto. And that's when Martin won the gold medal. And this was the front page of the Toronto Star. And they made about 10 of them. And so they sent me one, so nice souvenir. The parents of the players, we had very bad seats. We were behind the net. So I had my camera. I couldn't, you know, do any good picture. But when I forgot who it was, but he came to see me in between periods, and he said, you can have my seat. And his seat was perfect angle with Martin's net. So when it went over the jump, you know, with Simon Gagné, I got all kinds of good pictures, so I was very happy. That's mine when I won the bronze medal in my old woolen sweater, because we used to play outside rink. And Martin with his 2000. And that was the nicest moment for me, because I knew that, you know, we would have each a medal. And as it stands, I think that we're the only two Olympic members, father and son, with as a goalie, with each a medal. So it's quite special.
The 500 win club among National Hockey League goaltenders.
Well, if we start from the top picture to the right, is when Martin broke Jacques Plante and Terry Sawchuk for 340 wins every year. And this one there is my Olympic certificate and Martin and the Stanley Cup. Of course, this one is with the cup. Downstairs is when he won his 500th victory in Philadelphia. This is a nice sort of a painting we got from, I guess, from the NHL. And this is when his second cup in 2000. And the picture downstairs is when he beat the Bernard Perrin record. And there's two places open. You wonder why? Well, when he beats Patrick Roy, he'll be there. And when he beats Sawchuk, the two places will be filled. So I have the picture of Patrick that will go along with Martin, and I have the Sawchuk pictures too, so everybody's phoning him, and everybody's, you know, it's special. I don't know if I'm going to be there at all. It depends, you know. I'm going to try to be there too.
They had Patrick Waugh regarded to that point really as the greatest money goaltender of his era. They had him, and they let him off the hook.
In the spring of 2001, the Devils were out to become repeat Stanley Cup champions. Their last obstacle was the Colorado Avalanche. It meant a highly anticipated matchup between the two greatest French-Canadian goaltenders of all time, Martin Brodeur and Patrick Waugh, for hockey's Holy Grail.
Definitely, it's an exciting time, not just playing the Stanley Cup, but playing against him. You know, he's got the reputation of being one of the great clutch goalies, and then, we have a chance to face him and, hopefully beat him.
Brodeur had grown up idolizing Waugh and in his shadow. Nobody knew it at the time, but this would turn out to be Brodeur's only chance to knock off his rival in the playoffs. The Avalanche had a strong start, but just as they looked to be taking a stranglehold on the series, Patrick Waugh error had turned the tide in game four.
Waugh takes a look, sees Pandolfo, he's caught again. Pandolfo, what a score! They tie the game. Patrick got caught again.
Through five games, it was Brodeur and the Devils who took a 3-2 lead back home with a chance to wrap up the series. Away from repeating his champions and slaying his rival, Brodeur would allow an uncharacteristically soft opening goal.
Foot comes in, shoots, scores! Adam Foot carries across the line, and I think Brodeur got a piece of it.
it's in the net. One in the
that
net.
Goal would change the momentum in the series for good. The Avalanche went on to win Game 6 and then completed the comeback in the seventh game. For the first time in more than 25 years, a team had blown a 3-2 series lead in the Cup Final, and Brodeur was acutely aware of the golden opportunity that had slipped away.
The disappointment in losing that Game 7 to Colorado was that they had the champion on the ropes. They had Patrick Waugh, regarded to that point really as the greatest money goaltender of his era. They had him, and they let him off the hook.
The Devils followed up that heartbreak, finishing sixth in the Eastern Conference in 2002. That earned them a first-round matchup with Carolina. The effects of back-to-back lengthy playoff runs seemed to catch up with New Jersey in the postseason.
The Carolina Hurricanes have eliminated the New Jersey Devils in six games.
The disappointment of the first-round loss to the Hurricanes was all the motivation Brodeur needed as he entered 2003, more determined than ever.
He's one of those guys who always is trying to figure out a way to get back to winning. There was always that sort of, you know, chip on their shoulder in New Jersey, but always feeling that they had to prove something. People were saying, well, they got, you know, the one cup and the other two cup, but that's it. And I think the itch was there to prove that the Devils weren't just a one-trick pony or team and got lucky, but a team that was truly one of the best teams of its era.
Brodeur led the Devils to a second-place finish in the East with one of the best seasons of his career. A desire to play as many games as possible made Brodeur one of the league's workhorses. So it was no shock that he played 73 games in 2002-2003 for his sixth straight 70-game season.
What a save that was by Martin Brodeur!
To be as consistent as he was for as long as he was and to play as many games each season as he did, he's like the Iron Man of modern goaltenders.
The real test of success would come in the postseason. And first up for the Devils were the Boston Bruins.
A quick shot, Brodeur the save. Stop by Martin Brodeur. Rebound. Oh, what a stop by Martin Brodeur.
Martin Brodeur has his 13th career playoff shutout, and New Jersey has the lead in the series by that same 3-0 score.
Boston was able to take Game 4 to keep their hopes alive, heading to New Jersey for Game 5.
Back and quick for Helgill. Backhand shot stopped by Martin Brodeur.
Martin Brodeur sharp as a tack tonight.
And the Devils will leave this building tonight with a 3-0 victory. The Bruins go down in 5 games to the Devils.
Advancing beyond the first round was a good step. But given New Jersey's success, the Devils were determined to make a run deep into the playoffs. Next in line was Vincent LeCavalier and the Tampa Bay Lightning.
The series.
The Devils entered Game 5, one win shy of a berth in the conference final for the third time in 4 years.
Dan Boyle tees it up, Brodeur the save, rebound! Ken Dinkman is denied by Brodeur. Niedermeyer takes his shot, John Graham the save, loose it, Rebecca can score! Grant Marshall exits in the third overtime for New Jersey.
It would take 6 periods of hockey, a Grant Marshall goal, and a vintage Martin Brodeur performance. But the Devils were on their way to the Eastern Conference Final to meet the President Trophy-winning Ottawa Senators.
In front, Van Allen with a great chance. Score! Van Allen hits again. Beautiful goal. Well, what a game to start this Eastern Conference Final.
After dropping Game 1 in overtime, New Jersey bounced back to win 3 straights and headed to Ottawa for Game 5. Just one win shy of another berth in the final.
And a shot coming up. Score! Jason Spezza! For another day. As Hossa getting inside on that. What a chance! Score! Ottawa sent it to a seventh game.
We're going back in a building that definitely a position that we didn't want to be in, but, you know, we have to live with it and then, you know, hopefully pull one off.
Chances. Brace it as they fly. saves in the game, and the Devils move on to meet Anaheim for the Stanley Cup.
The Devils were off to their third Cup final appearance in 4 years. The series would be a battle of goaltenders from Quebec, as J.S. Jaguar was the primary reason behind the Ducks' success.
He's been playing awesome. I think technically he's as good as anybody out there, and he's playing with a lot of confidence.
You know, he's got a couple of Stanley Cup and Olympic ring and all that. So, you know, obviously a great goaltender, a guy I look up to when I was a kid.
New Jersey held home ice advantage where they were 8-1 to that point in the postseason. Back-to-back shutouts gave him 6 in the playoffs, tying him with the most in one playoff year with Dominic Hasek, as the Devils headed west with a commanding 2-0 series lead.
Down across the line, Oza Lynch again. Try to look out, it's in the net! Brodeur came out and lost a stick, and it hit a stick, and it slipped behind him, and it's in the goal! It's dropped back by Oates. Score!
Jaguar stymied the Devils in Anaheim, giving the Ducks momentum as the series shifted back to the Swamp for Game 5.
Passed it from wide open, Ozalich stopped. That was a chance. That was a golden opportunity. Game over.
Home cooking continued to go a long way in this series as the Ducks staved off elimination in Game 6. The Devils had hoped to avoid the same fate as 2001 when they couldn't end the series in 6 games. It would come down to Game 7 in New Jersey.
Shot is grabbed by Brodeur. And here's Friesen. Oh, and a ball scores! Friesen gets another one. And that should be it, baby. 3-0. That's too much of a mountain to climb.
Brodeur's blanking in Game 7 was his 7th shot out of the playoffs, setting a new record for one playoff season. 3 of his 4 wins against the Ducks were shutouts, tying another all-time record in one playoff round. Despite all of these feats, there was one thing missing, and that was the Conn Smythe Trophy, which was awarded to Anaheim's J.S. Jaguar.
Brodeur gets 3 shutouts in the series, including Game 7, only the 3rd goaltender ever to get a shutout in Game 7 of a Stanley Cup final. And this clinches the Devils' 3rd Stanley Cup in 8 years. And still nobody's pointing to him and saying he was the guy who made the difference. I think it bothered him. It would have bothered him a lot more to win the Conn Smythe and not win the Stanley Cup. Cups have always been what matters most to him.
As a friendship, I mean, you know, we can't find any better person. I mean, he's been exceptionally, you know, he's like a son to me.
Since Martin Brodeur's arrival in the NHL, 2 men have been fixtures with the New Jersey Devils franchise, Lou Lamoriello and goaltender coach Jacques Caron. A former goalie himself, Caron began his career with the Devils in 1993, Brodeur's rookie year.
Fires and a save, Brodeur, rebound, oh, and another save off Roberts.
We knew we had something special, but you never know. You know, I mean, we had a good club. We knew we had a good club. And playing with a good club gives him more confidence also. You could tell right away when he started to play. You could see the change. He was trying to stand up a little bit more, dissipation. And he learned so fast, I couldn't believe it. You know, when he won the rookie of the year that year. And he just adjusts to everything so fast. And that's what I was telling Lou. I said, this kid's a real thing.
We all know the job that Jacques Caron has done with our goaltending throughout the years. And he was the perfect fit for Marty as far as patience, as far as instruction, and just the way he saw his abilities and to maximize his talent.
To this day, we do what we started 16 years ago. We have a meeting every night before every game, going to the previous game on the tape. He's so smart as a goaltender because he knows all the players in the National League. He knows their habits, the shooters, the passers. So his anticipation becomes so easy for him. That's why we figure, you know, every night you'll see him making those great saves. It's all great. It's not guessing. Guessing and anticipating is two different things. Guessing, some night you'll be guessing right. Anticipation, you'll play very steady. And that's what he's been doing for all these years.
Out in front. Oh, what a great stop by Brodeur on Kotalika.
Three Stanley Cups, one gold medal, a World Cup. Despite all of Brodeur's successes, it's his desire to improve that allows the student-teacher relationship to thrive.
Goalies, they say they're different. And Marty sure is different because he's probably the easiest goaltender to work with. For him to carry on after 16 years insisting, and what I say to him, you always try to do it. It's amazing, you know, because a star, a superstar, whatever you want to call him, you know, sometimes they would get a big head and everything, but never happened with him. And that's what I like about him a lot.
Rebound chance, what a stop! Oh my goodness, Marty Brodeur, down and out!
As teammates and coaches have come and gone over the years for Martin Brodeur, Jacques Caron remains. Through 16 seasons together, the bond between player and coach couldn't be stronger.
I call him every 3 days, 2 days, to see how he's doing, or he calls me. And even when my wife was very sick and I was not here, we'd call every 2 days. I'd watch his game, he'd call me, what do you see? As a friendship, I mean, you know, we can't find any better person. I mean, he's like a son to me, to be honest with you. And I care for him, you know, not just in hockey. I care about his family. I care about how he thinks all the time. And I think you could call me his mentor, whatever you want, but I think it takes two to succeed like that. I mean, you know, at first I started like, we didn't know where we were going. He didn't know, I didn't know. I felt I had knowledge and he had the talent. And if we could put it together, you know, I thought he could be a pretty good goaltender, but I never thought he would become Martin, the best goaltender in the world. And it's a real feather in my cap to be part of his life.
Right on him, shot, save Brodeur. Brodeur, with his 30th win of the season, extends his own NHL record.
His sixth shutout of the season.
And when he throws a turn, Brodeur, and he's able to cover. He stopped 39 out of 39 for his 52nd career shutout.
I'll tell you, seven shutouts in the playoffs is a record. Martin Brodeur, and three in the final. That ties the record.
Sensational save. He's still after that elusive 400th win. This is his third try.
There's a great shot.
That's a relief.
I bet it is, Marty.
Here's Sikora's shot. Save.
My
find White on him. Shot! Save Brodeur!
Brodeur, with his 30th win of the season, extends his own NHL record of consecutive 30-win seasons to 10.
Shoots Brodeur the save. He wasn't sure. It picks up Brodeur a save. Blake gets away. Puck still loose. It comes out.
The 86th shutout in the Hall of Fame debut career of Martin Brodeur.
To Marty Brodeur.
Here's a chance in front by Richards and a save made by Marty Brodeur. A chance now for Briere. Briere fed it across. Canoe with a shot. Save Brodeur. Rebound. Briere. Oh, and he didn't get it home.
Oh, Marty, you were at your best tonight.
It is done. 500 wins for Marty Brodeur. A feeding one in front. Kelly. Oh, by Brodeur. Rebound is held by Brodeur. Backhands one. Save. Rebound.
Vintage Brodeur.
And the visitor goes to Martin Brodeur from the New Jersey Devils.
He just found a way to win all the time.
Just a calm, cool, collected cat.
Martin Brodeur looking sharp.
He's the best I've seen.
Start with one simple open-ended question. When I say Martin Brodeur, what immediately comes to mind?
Winning.
A lot of Stanley Cups and a lot of Vezinas.
Frustration for a lot of years.
Ability to play in big games.
Just a calm, cool, collected cat.
He just found a way to win all the time, and he did as good or better than anybody who ever played.
Brodeur looking for the goal! Down the ice! Score! Martin!
He's terrific with the puck. He is absolutely terrific with the puck. I think there's other guys that are close to him, but I think he is the best.
He's athletic. That's why he could get out. He's good on skates, can skate really well. He's not nervous type. Sometimes he looks less nervous than the forwards with the puck.
There's the great puck handling skills of the goaltender to get it out.
For us, yeah, it was great because he handles the puck so well. And it's not just getting the puck and firing it. I mean, he's getting the puck and making a stick-to-stick pass.
Marty Brodeur probably prolonged my career by 5 years. It was like, well, you knew I could go 9 miles out back, a guy could be breathing down my neck. If he had control of it, it was going right up to a winger. And yeah, he saved me many times, a lot of us defensive, from getting our head slammed against the boards, no question about it.
Playing a pass across to Elias. Maybe he'll get an assist.
We used to bang our heads against the wall, trying to keep the puck away from Marty so that we could get in on a forecheck. And more often than not, because of his quickness, he could get out there and get the puck regardless of where it was. He wrapped it hard, he could get to it. And then it was simply a matter of finding the open man. And he was like another guy back there.
You have to adjust your game to it. There's no question about it. And it really helped his defense. And they just had such a nice system of it. I mean, the communication was there. And the times he wouldn't go out, they knew it. And the times he would go out, they were ready for a pass, holding up guys. Really worked beautifully.
There was no way that we were going to beat New Jersey by letting Marty get the puck all the time. More often than not, we'd come back yelling at each other on the bench, keep it away from the goaltender.
To have him back there to get the puck and just be able to get out and give him out and get the pass on your stick, he passed the puck better than some defensemen.
No goalie has ever put together 9 straight 30-win years until now.
It's amazing how many games you've played. I mean, something that I could never do, that's for sure, playing 70-some games and performing in the playoffs. And I couldn't do that.
I would say it's mind-boggling to play at that high a level for that long. Is an incredible feat.
He's 70 game a year guy. It's, you know, which is, you know, adds, that's probably another 5 years for a lot of goalies also. You know, they play, some play 50, 60, and, you know, he's 70, 75.
What a stop by Marty Brodeur, vintage Brodeur.
Some of the saves that he makes, I mean, such acrobatic moves and the stretches and everything else, you'd think he was gonna pull something somewhere along the line.
It's almost like he has that rubber body or the body that's just, you know, he's very loose.
Combine excellence at your position with the durability and the amount of games is really unique.
Look out, it's in it! Brodeur came out and lost his stick! And it's living proof that even Betty Crocker burns the odd cake.
Probably has the best temperament that I've ever seen for a goaltender.
Marty just every night, the same demeanor, no matter what. One goal in, five goals in, shutout, whatever. Every day is the same thing and just shows up ready to play.
He's the type of guy that, you know, nothing seems to faze him. It's amazing. Even a bad goal, he'll flick it off his, you know, his mind right away, and he'll go and make five great saves after.
You don't see Marty have very many bad games. You know, and when he does, he comes back with a big one. You know, it's usually either a shutout or one goal game.
You just get a kick out of Marty. You know, he puts his helmet up like that. He's drinking water. He always seems to have a smile on his face. He's yapping with the ref, whatever he's doing. It doesn't seem like his man who's in any way under pressure out there.
I've seen goalies that vomit before the game and they had to go to the bathroom five times because they were in the, they had to play a big game. Not this guy.
His demeanor is exceptional for the position that he plays. In fact, is unique and almost unheard of in this day and age. His composure and how he treats his teammates when there is a mistake or isn't a mistake. It's always with tremendous respect.
Martin Brodeur looking solid. Yes, sir. He's the best, no doubt about it.
I think when it's all said and done, the best, no doubt about it.
I think Marty's number one. I mean, I think he's got to be number one.
I feel the best goalie ever to play the game.
I compare Marty to Jock Plante, Glenn Hall, and Sawchuk. He's a combination of all the best, and that's why he's the best.
I think in the modern day, I think Marty Brodeur is the best goaltender that's played the game.
You look at what Marty's done, you know, three Stanley Cups, brought the team out of, you know, basically being in the basement of the league. What else is out there?
You can't play that long and be that good on that many teams without just being an excellent player.
He's the best I've seen. It'll be, you know, a long time before we see anyone do what he has done on a consistent basis over a period of time at the highest level.
We're seeing Marty Brodeur becoming the best goalie ever in the National Hockey League, and no other goalie to follow him will ever play the way he has.
He said, look, he says, we had a meeting last night and we voted to name the Martin Brodeur Arena. Well, you got me crying there.
It's kind of funny every time you get a little smile at it when you see your name attached to an arena.
Two years, 613 goaltenders have played at least a period in the NHL. Some of them two decades. Some of them did not wear masks, had only a baseball fielder's glove to catch with. 8.9 to go, Taves against Matt. Taves flopped it on back. Barker kept it, shot one, blocked down in front. Oh, and a bad stop made by Brodeur. Cleared back, a long not out. One more by Barker, blocked. And Marty Brodeur is the winningest goaltender in the NHL.
That was an exciting night, you know. I think definitely I'm real happy that it's done and over with, you know. It's been kind of chaotic a little bit for me the last few days, but you know, it was an awesome night. It was a great reception from the fans. You know, I thought it was pretty cold in Montreal, but this stopped it. You know, it was as fun. You know, it was awesome.
It's hard. You know, I've been really fortunate to play in a great organization, and, you know, I always going to remember my first win here against Boston, but, you know, it's a long time ago. So, you know, hopefully we'll play a few more years and get this record as high as possible. So for the next one coming, it'll be a big challenge for him to get it. Like any good photographer, he didn't want to miss me taking some pictures with that winning puck. You know, I think that was his main goal after the hug.
It's been a great ride, there's no doubt about it. From day one to now, and hopefully for the rest of my career, you know, playing for one organization, being so successful as a team, as an organization, and what we, every year we try to accomplish, and it's hard.
He's one of the only guys who played all his career with one team. There's some players, sometimes they jump a bad team to go to a good team. That helps them out in winning, but Martin stayed with the team that was good all the time, just playing good hockey all the time.
You know, last year was our 11th straight time in the playoffs. We missed only, since I've been there, once the playoffs. I mean, that's what you play hockey for. You know, you have a chance to win every day. For me, it's, you know, all the great people I met through this organization, the Doug Gilmores, the McGillneys, Larionov, Fetisov. I mean, I'm missing Stefan Richey, Claude Lemieux, missing tons of guys. I was playing with the hockey legend with Scott Stevens, and Niedermeyer will be in there, Ken Danico in New Jersey. So it's kind of, you don't forget these things.
The one thing is to play 15 seasons with the same caliber. You know, when Martin started, he had some good, every year he has a good season. You know, you see maybe some goaltenders, it's not their fault, but that's what it is. They go high for 2 years or 3 years, and then they fold. But Martin, he's been the same steady goaltender. He's won the same amount of game. And if you do that for 15 years, that's something that can be remembered.
All my life, you know, it's such a big part. You know, my family is in New Jersey. They were all born in New Jersey. They all play hockey. The kids are in Jersey in school there. They're Americans, and for me to have that kind of life, you know, coming in from St. Leonard in Montreal, you know, now, you know, for me, I'm like an American, you know, so it's awesome.
It's that same loyalty that saw Brodeur bring the Stanley Cup back to St. Leonard each time he won it, playing a game of street hockey for the Cup with the same nine friends he grew up with.
It's a dream that every kid or every children wants to live. And Marty made us live it through him.
The nine guys who stayed on that street, they are still friendly. They're always together when Martin comes back. And this is where the Stanley Cup was when they played that street hockey game. Of course, all the kids around, they would come around and have a picture taken with the cup. In 95, they played a street hockey game and Martin lost the cup. And he regained the cup in 2000 and 2003.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Yeah.
Till now, he won three Stanley Cup, and every time he wins it, it's like we're winning it with him, you know? It's a feeling that can't be described.
Perhaps Brodeur's greatest honor came after his second Stanley Cup. The St. Leonard Arena, where he grew up playing minor hockey, was renamed Martin Brodeur Arena.
In 2000, he won his second Stanley Cup. So I, you know, one afternoon I was asked by the mayor to see him at his office, and he said, "Look," he says, "we had a meeting last night and we voted to name the Martin Brodeur Arena." Well, and, he got me crying there because I knew that that Remo Bourque at the arena is the name, Jacques Plante, a lot of hockey players had that, but I never thought that, you know, in my neighborhood that they would name the arena under his name. Well, it's so nice, you know, especially when there's a lot of people in the rink and you see the younger kids come out and see Martin's picture when he was young. So I think that's good for them. It just shows that wherever you come from a big city or a small city, that the dream come true can happen.
It's hard for me. I never call it that name. You know, I say that name because I have a hard time saying it. You know, for me, it's always Arena St. Leonhard all the time. It's hard. And even though when we go out in the summer and we go play ball hockey or whatever there, I can't, you know, I know the kids do call it like that, but it's kind of funny. Every time you get a little smile at it when you see your name attached to an arena.
You can't even say it.
I have a hard time.
They're switching draft picks. Now, what the ramifications are of that, we'll have to wait and see.
The championship to New Jersey. The Devils win the Stanley Cup. The Devils of New Jersey have won the Stanley Cup. There hasn't been this much excitement in this building for a long time. What a remarkable save by Brodeur.
This is one of the best you'll ever see.
The best, no doubt about it.